Currently at a career high ranking of number 2 on the ATP, today's guest has already won 11 ATP Tour titles, including 3 Masters 1000 tournaments and the 2020 ATP Tour Finals. Welcome to Talk Tennis with Tennis Warehouse, Daniil Medvedev. Thank you so much for joining today.
Thank you. Thank you for telling who I am. That's always nice to hear.
Yeah, I mean, quite the accomplishment. And again, you're so entertaining to watch. Mad respect for you. Like, the weakest part of my game is my brain. And it seems like that's like the strongest part of your game. So I'm always respecting how you play and how you work out there on the court.
Yeah, well, I just, you know, for me, the most important thing, first of all, is to win. Then there comes different other things, but the first one is to win. So that's what was always on my mind since I was young. So let's put it this way. I was carrying much less to make a twinner a winner than to try to turn around the ball and, I don't know, try to stay in the point and to win the point like this. So that's how maybe I developed kind of the tactics that I used to actually try to win the game. They don't work all the time, which is completely normal. But I'm trying to do my best to try to make it as many times as possible.
Well, and I wanted to talk about gear, but before we get into that, I've heard you're quite the chess player, and that's something that you're passionate about off the court. And we see that kind of mindset on the court. So can you tell me a little bit about that and like what you love about chess and how it became something that you enjoy?
Well, now I don't play chess at all, I want to say. Okay. And so I'm not good. When you don't practice at something, you become not good at it. So I'm not good at all in chess right now. But I liked chess when I was younger. I think I was quite a good player. I was, going to a chess school from maybe for 2 years since I was 5 till maybe 7. So,
wow.
So I like this game. I like the tactics about it. The only thing I know that to play good, I need to play it every day. I need to learn, some tactics, some basics, which I don't have time right now. And I know that even if I start, I won't be good. So that's why I don't play it anymore. But I like to think that sometimes you can use it on the tennis court.
For sure. So on this podcast, we love to talk to players about their gear, and you have some awesome gear that you're out there with as your weapon of choice. So let's talk a little bit about Tecnifibre and the brand and how you came to start working with Tecnifibre. What was that relationship like? How did you start working with them? When was the first time you even picked up a Tecnifibre racket?
First time I picked a Tecnifibre racket, I was, if I'm not mistaken, 19 years old. I was 18 years old, just about to turn 19. And they came with an offer because my contract with the previous brand was expiring. So I was thinking, how do I continue my career? I was 330 at the time. I think I finished the year 331 or something around this. I was the end of 2016, I would say, if I'm not mistaken. I might be. No, probably 2015. And Tecnifibre was, one of the brands that showed the most interest, I would say, in me. So I was like, okay, I need to try the racket. I need to see how it works out. And I really liked the approach because straight away I met the main, how we can call it, the main coordinator between players and the brand. He doesn't work there anymore, Guillaume Ducreuil, but he's a really nice guy, and he kind of brought me to Tecnifibre, one of the guys also. And I remember very well first two tournaments were challengers in Bangkok, and I was not playing that well. I won one round, but I was not playing amazing. And of course, straight away after you've been playing with something for all your life, you start questioning yourself too. Right. Did I make the right choice? Is my career going to be good with this racket? Am I going to be able to play good? And well, the year I started 330, so I had doubts and questions in myself, and I finished the year 98, which is a huge progression. Yeah, and I was not talked about in the media. I was not the, you know, how we call it, the next gen and everything. Nobody cared about me, but I made a huge step. I think at the time when I finished top 100, I was maybe one of the 5-6 guys of my age who were there, which was really good, was really important to me. And since that year, I mean, I loved the racket. I was playing amazing. completely honest, you can ask other junior guys. I had a huge problem on my forehand before. Like, you could play on my forehand and you could win the match just by doing this. And my backhand was really good. You know, it might sound stupid or anything, but with Tecnifibre racquet, I managed to play much better forehand. So it was not anymore a weak point in my game. And that's how I managed to be in the top 100. And then it was only going up from there. And I still play with this racquet. And I don't think I will ever change during my career.
Wow. I mean, that's awesome.
I think that's not many times I tell this story. So it's going to be something new. That's always nice to give something new to fans and to people who follow me.
Definitely, for sure. Our listeners love when players geek out about their gear. And obviously, you're a good one that knows what you're working with. And you've got the TFight 305 RS in your hands out there right now. And something about your racquet is a little bit different than a lot of rackets on tour that we've seen. It's the 18 by 19 string pattern. Can you talk to me a little bit about that string pattern, why it works for you? Did you have input in asking for that and how that came about?
First of all, I don't know if there is any other racquet who's 18-19 also. I'm not sure.
Right.
Because I don't follow other brands, I need to be honest. The thing about this racquet is that this racquet I started using when I came to Tecnifibre, and it has worked out well. And as a tennis player, you always try to find new things to try to improve my game. And at the same time, you try to maintain things that work good. And again, the racquet was something that worked good. So it's a funny question. You never know. Maybe I would use 18-20 and I would play even better, but I doubt so. So I really like it. I think it suits well my flat strokes together with razor cut strings. It really suits my game, which maybe will not suit some Spanish player who spins a lot and turns around with the forehand and plays on clay. But for me, it suits my game perfectly. And this 18-19, I think, is really good for flat strokes.
I would agree. It seems to be working really well out there for you. And how would you describe your style of game? Because I watch you out there and I also hit very flat. But what you can pull off that I can't pull off is I go for you already talked about your main goal is winning and getting the ball back. Instead of hitting that crazy flashy shot, you're going to get the ball back. But you're on the run sometimes and you just hit these amazing shots that like seem unmakeable and you have the ability to make them. And I'm sure part of that has to do with your talent, your brain, but also your gear. So explain to me your style game and who else kind of would benefit from this racket aside from just a flat hitter.
Yeah, I mean, if we talk about my style of game, it's a bit tough to talk because it depends the surface, it depends the opponent you play. I'm sometimes considered as a defensive player, but to be honest, it's usually when I play not good that I go into a defensive mode a little bit to try to hit more balls in the court and at least say, okay, I maybe don't play good today, but you need to win yourself to try to win the match because that's when I feel that if I go for winners, I will miss. At the same time, when I'm feeling good, there are so many matches where I hit more winners than my opponents. So I go full power on serve. I try to hit winners. I try to play aggressive. So I consider myself as, let's put it like this. I remember when there were tennis games, there is a sovereign volley player, big strokes player. I would say all-around player. Maybe yeah. The volley is the part I need to work on. But if we talk about baseline, all-court player, all-around player. And of course, that's what I'm working on practice with my coach. For example, a few years ago, we felt like, okay, I maybe not mastered, but I started to be good in this defensive, counter-defensive style of play. So now we need to work on attacking more, putting the pressure on the opponent to try to improve my game. And that's what we have been working on. We work a lot on the volley, even if sometimes it's not my best part of my game, but I can be good at the net also. So I'm trying to work everything and I feel, yeah, pretty good about it.
Awesome. Now let's talk a little bit about your string setup. You mentioned Razor Code White is in your strings. What tension do you string at around? Obviously, you probably change it depending on your location and what surface. And then do you have a routine when switching rackets? Like, are you very particular about when you want fresh strings or do you kind of just know or tell me how it works for you?
Yeah, I can be from one side of you. I know players that are completely 10 times more crazy about strings and rackets than me. But I'm still somewhere in the middle or close to this because, so for example, I don't see the difference if I string it, let's say I usually string around 22 on 22 around this. So some players, I know some players, they would be like, they would touch a racket, hit a few balls and say, no, I need 21.9.
Yeah.
This is not me. You give me 21.5, 22, I won't tell you the difference. I'll probably say the opposite. So this is not that important to me. I just know the what I usually use. And then I try to see, okay, I miss a lot in the deep. So I try to go up with the tension and small details like this. But where I'm special, and I don't think there are many players who do it, I'm able to play five setter without changing a racket. I don't change the wow. racket for fresh balls. Because I have, in my opinion, a special connection with the racket I play. And when I change it for another one with the new strings, I might lose this connection. Out of three sets, if I feel good, I never change the racket, even on clay.
I love that. Yeah. That makes complete sense. That's amazing.
Yeah, because on clay, when I practice on hard courts, I would break strings probably once a week. And when other players can break three rackets per day, the strings, I mean, not the rackets,
right.
but that's why I said on clay, because on clay, well, even me, I would probably break strings once in 2 days. So that's why I need to change more on clay.
Got it. Now tell me about your string bet a little bit more. Why does this string setup work for you? What are you looking for out of your string? So I personally am always looking for more control from my string bed. What do you need out of your string bed?
I like when my ball flies in the air, and that's what can be, that's why I'm sometimes really dependent on the ball they give on the tournament, because every tennis ball is so different. That's where you need to adapt your strings, and it's tough to explain. It depends on humidity, it depends everything. You just need to feel it. You just need to know what, exactly, as you say, what you're looking for. So if we talk about me, I like when my ball flies in the air. So that's why I think I try to string quite low. Mm-hmm. I don't go under 20 usually, even if some players do. Also the players that like when their ball goes fast in the air. I try to keep it quite low, as I say, 22, 21, something around this. So the ball comes out fast from my strings. And like this, I can control it, where it goes more.
Awesome. Makes sense. Let's talk a little bit about footwear. I know you've made a switch in shoes recently, and I actually was hoping to get a pair, but they sold out so fast. And I've heard so many great things about the Lacoste AG LT21 Ultra shoes. So talk to me about these shoes and how much you helped design them, or if you got to test them as they were being created.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, it's very tricky to change shoes. So you are scared. As for the racket, as for everything, shoes is very important for a tennis player, because movement is, I think, one of the most important aspects after maybe forehand and backhand. And still, we can discuss it. So far, I played only one tournament on hard courts in these shoes, played on clay and grass, and I can say they were amazing, really. I was really, careful with what I was saying in the beginning, because you never know what's going to happen. Maybe in 1 week something going to happen and you're going to say, okay, maybe we need to change something. So I was really careful. Now I say it out loud. I really like the shoe. Feels amazing on the foot. I still run very good. I think that's the most important part to see, where I'm not lying about what I say. I still run pretty good on the court. Yeah, I feel good about it. And it was, I think, a tough job for Lacoste to make it, because they were doing it for 3 or 4 years. They were developing the project of this shoe. So 1 year ago, I kind of came on board to try to help them with my knowledge. Of course, I don't know how to build a tennis shoe, but I can help to say what I feel needs to be improved. So we were working together, and that's how I think we built a pretty good shoe. After, the most important thing is to ask tennis fans, as you say, they sold out. So we need to find these guys and ask what do they think. I really hope they like it because I feel pressure on my shoulders because of this.
Well, I know you do have pressure on your shoulders. And I know the shoe you wore previously, a lot of other players also wore those shoes previously and they're looking for a shoe to get into. So, and you're one of the fastest, like best movers on tour. So I guess so far from what you've said, this is a good option. Do you prefer, if you had to pick speed over stability, do you have a, would you be able to pick one or you need both? Like what is the most important thing you need from your shoes?
Well, you need both, but I would pick speed because I'm going to say like, okay, I'm going to work with my physical coach to try to be stable after. I'm going to be very strong mentally to, you know, to prepare myself to be stable, and speed is the most important for me.
Nice. I love it. And we see you pick up and just get to every single ball on the court. So obviously that makes complete sense. You said you've only worn them at one hard court tournament, but we're going into hard court season. How often do you wear out your outsoles or you are rotating shoes all the time?
Outsoles, you mean the things that you put inside?
No, the bottom of the shoe.
Ah, the bottom. I usually, because I slide on hard courts,
right,
more than I do on clay or grass. It's the inside part of the shoe that gets broken.
Okay.
And that's where we made a big job with Lacoste because hard courts nowadays are so abrasive, if it's the right word. So no matter what you do, you're not going to make a perfect shoe where you're not going to break it a little bit. But we tried to make it as strong as possible. And so like this, I can maybe keep a new shoe for 3 matches on hard courts, I would say. You can play in it all the tournament, but then it's going to get a little bit dangerous whether maybe something going to happen because we play in humid conditions. So the shoe gets wet, we slide, the court is really strong. So I prefer, I usually change it once in two, 3 matches. But again, we've done a good job to try to make it as durable as possible. So I think when I practice, I can play in one shoe for 2 weeks easy. But awesome. It's just for the matches where you need to be sure that nothing's going to go wrong.
Definitely. Okay, let's do some fun questions. The Olympics are coming up. Yeah, let's go. Olympics are coming up. What are you most looking forward to? And talk to me about your camaraderie with your fellow Russian players.
Well, everything. It's my first Olympics. Of course, it's going to be, unfortunately, a bit different from normal Olympics. We cannot see other sports. No people there. But it's still the first Olympics. So I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be first time I'm going to be in the Olympic Village. Everything going to be for the first time to me. It's actually funny because it's going to be the first time we'll play doubles with Karatsev. I think we can make a good double. Maybe, of course, not the best in the world, but we can try to make some damage, if I can say like this. And I think that's the things I'm looking forward to the most. And, of course, I'm there to try to win a medal for the country in singles, but it's going to be tough because there are amazing players there.
Who else is on your team from Russia?
We have a strong team. We have me, Rublev, Kachanov, and Karatsev. So it's a pretty strong team. It's not a Davis Cup. It's an individual tournament, kind of. I think the more Russians are going to be in the later stages, the better.
And it's pretty cool. It seems like you guys kind of all grew up together. So you've known each other for quite a long time and have competed alongside each other and against each other. So it should be awesome.
Yeah, I always said that me, Karen, and Andrei were same age. Andrei is 1 year younger, but at one point it stops to make a difference. In my opinion, we always pushed each other to be better. And, you know, in different times of our careers, we were all number one in Russia at one point. I was for a long time, I would say, really kind of behind them, really close, but behind them. And I always wanted to be number one. I think it's the same for both of them. And, you know, as I say, right now I'm the number one, but Andrei is pretty close. Karen maybe dropped his level a little bit, but made quarters in Wimbledon, mm-hmm. going further than me and Andrei. So it's all about this competitivity where, of course, we care more about our results, even if there would not be Karen and Andrei, I would try to be number two in the world. I would try to make great results and everything, but it helps. This competition helps. And we are also great friends, so we can spend a lot of time together. After the match, we're not going to, you know, not talk with each other for 1 week because this is tennis and it helps because tennis is a lonely sport. It's true. And it helps to have some friends around you like this.
Well, and that's what I wanted to ask you too, is like, how do you combat a bad day? Like, you're just not interested. Something bad happened off the court. Like, how do you move forward?
Everybody does it differently. I can say my way because I don't hide it. I take tennis really seriously. I try to do my best, but I also understand that there is life without tennis. So, for example, let's talk about last loss I had against Uber Urkash. I felt like I was on top of him in the first day. Then we got postponed and literally I couldn't do anything to the next day to try to stop him. He played good. I didn't play good enough. Was very disappointing because the day before I felt like I had to win in three sets. I didn't manage to do it. And the next day I'm sitting in the locker room understanding that, okay, Wimbledon is over for me where I had big hopes. I need to take my tickets back home. That's the tough part. But I also understand that this is a sport, you know, watch football. It's the same. Everybody was talking France is going to win Euros 5-0 against everybody. Well, they didn't even come to quarters. So it's same in every sport. I try to do my best every time I'm on court. Of course, I'm disappointed for some time after the match, but I try to really fast regroup and say, okay, there are going to be more tournaments, more slams coming. I'm going to try to do my best. I'm going to try to win it. And even if I don't, I did my best. I have life outside of tennis. I enjoy life. And that's how I am able after 1 week talking to you and being in a good mood.
We're not crying.
I need to be honest. There are some players that are not able to do it. And I think that's really tough. So I try not to be this tough.
I absolutely love how authentic you are. And you're someone that every time I listen to you speak, it really resonates because you're saying exactly how you feel. Sometimes it's very emotional. I just watched the speech you gave at the Australian Open final this year. And you were so kind to Djokovic and you just always kind of have this way of speaking exactly what you think. And I love that. So I have to imagine you have such a great team around you. Talk to me a little bit about how they, you know, help you on these tough days and how you just kind of remain authentic, especially in a time where players are hiding from the tough stuff.
Well, I am hiding also some things. That's why I try to talk only about the things I can be honest about. And if it's a question where I can't, for different reasons, it can be sponsors, it can be a modern world where we cannot say all what we think. These questions, I just ignore them and go to the next one. But I want people to know who I am. And the funny thing is that on tennis court, sometimes I'm not who I am actually in real life. It's different. There is some sport character and attitude that comes out of me, which is of course part of me as a sportsman, but as a sportsman, not as a person. And that's why in the speech and everything, I think people can be like, well, that we didn't think he's like this, but that's the difference of me as a sportsman on court. And I separate these two positions and me in life, laying on the sofa or whatever. And yeah, talking about my team, for already a long time, I have the same team around me. I won't mention everybody, but they are the big part of my success. Without them, I would not be where I am. They're all French, except of course my family and my wife. All the tennis part of the team is French. Yeah, I can speak French, so it helps. And not much more to add, that they're the most professional guys I know in my life. When I say it is that they do their best to try to help me reach the highest level, because of course it's let's put it this way. I'm the car and they are the engine and the constructors of the car. And well, if the car is bad, it's not going to help. Yeah. But if the engine, the car is good, but the engine and the constructors are not good, it's also not very efficient. So that's how I see it. And I'm happy with my team. Not much to add. If I would not be happy, I would not be with them.
Yeah, that's awesome. And it's kind of fun that your team is all French and also your sponsors are French. So
a big part of my life is French. And what is funny, I speak French and my wife speaks French. So yeah, probably France is a second country in our blood. Let's call it like this.
That's awesome. I love it. What has been the most meaningful title for you?
I need to be honest. Every title starting from juniors was really meaningful to me in a different ways. But if we talk about big titles, I would mention, of course, London ATP Finals, being the top three in the world. All top three was just a special feeling. And I want to mention Shanghai because it was the tournament where I just came from a crazy US series where I made finals of Washington, finals of Montreal, won Cincy, made US Open final. And so kind of after this result, you can say, okay, I'm a top player. I can play good against anybody. But still, I just came to this level and you're never 100% sure what's going to bring to you next, the life in tennis. And so Shanghai was like 1 month after, and I managed to win it. It was my second master title. And this gave me even more confidence, more boost of confidence, where it kind of reassured me that, okay, I actually can do this. And so it has a special place in my heart. And I really like the city. I played the Challenger there once. It was my best result in Challenger at the time. And I had some good time in Shanghai, and I really love the city.
Awesome. And it seems like you start catching fire around the US Open series, hard court swing, and that's coming up. Let's go. Do you think there's any connection to maybe growing up on the fast Russian hard courts and the US Open swing, or just kind of works out that way? Any reason why you think you do so well during this time of year?
First and main important reason is the temperature, the conditions, and the courts. It's humid, it's hot, and it's fast, of course, but not too fast, like it's not terrific or whatever. So it suits my game perfectly. I really like to play in USA, always loved. It's very tough physically because it's super hot at this time. In Cincinnati, you can basically feel like you're dying on the court, everybody. Yeah. So it's not tough. It's not easy physically. After the match sometimes, after even the match you won, you're like, wow, I don't think I'm going to go out tomorrow. I just can't anymore. But for my game, it suits perfectly. So I will be always looking forward to the US Open series, to the US Open itself, especially after, you know, the run I had last year, there were no crowds. So I'm really looking forward to playing with the crowd and seeing how it's going to go. I hope it's going to be amazing and fire like always in New York.
Yes, I know. I'm excited and everyone's going to be excited to watch and tune in. Last question. Is there anything on your bucket list, tennis related or otherwise?
I like to travel. I think I have a lot of things in bucket list, but first thing that comes to my mind is I like to travel. I've never been to South America yet. So that's one of the parts. And I think a lot of places in the world where I want to be at least once, which is not easy with the life of a tennis player. And then probably I'm going to have kids. They're going to go to school or whatever. So I won't be able to take 1 year where I'm going to say, okay, I go all around the world, you know. Yeah. But I want to try to find time to visit new places. And if I have to choose one, let's say I need to choose one on the bucket list, I want to say Antarctica. I don't know in English, the South Pole, basically. I don't know.
Because
in Russian, it's Antarctida, but I don't know. In English, it's probably Antarctica. I want to go on South Pole and just see how it is there. Because, I know that they make it, so...
That's so cool. And I have to say, they wanted me to start by giving you a Russian phrase, but I am horrible at saying anything in another language. So I didn't do it for your sake.
No worries.
But thank you so much for joining me, Daniil. This was such a fun chat. And I appreciate you taking the time on your busy day, getting ready for all the things, all your trainings and everything else. And we are wishing you all the luck with everything coming forward to you, and hopefully you get to Antarctica, the South Pole, very soon. I'm so excited for that too. That sounds awesome. So thank you so much for joining. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for the interview. It was super fun.